I'm Joe Kistel, and recently I was going to purchase a camera crane for an upcoming project. My idea of a camera crane was to get camera movement up and down while keeping the camera in a level orientation. I figured I can make one myself out of what I had, and I'm going to show you guys how I got that done. I happen to have a 10-foot piece of 2x1 oval tubing, and that will work great for a boom. I also had 1-inch angle, and I thought that would work well for the pivoting legs. And I also had 2-inch angle, and I thought that would work great for the camera base and where the rig will actually attach to a foundation. The first thing I wanted to do was cut the boom pieces. One had to be longer than the other, so I basically made a rough measurement. I said, hey, let's have a piece around 6 feet and a piece around 4 feet. So I made the measurements, and I cut the aluminum tubing in half using an angle grinder with a metal cutoff wheel. Now I also needed pivoting legs, each one of those legs 10 inches in length. Once I had the angle measured, I cut those legs with the angle grinder as well. Now I wanted to make sure the booms were equal distance apart, so what I did is I took two PVC fittings and placed them between the booms, and then I clamped the booms down in a flush position, ensuring that they were going to stay an equal distance apart. Now I wanted to mark my holes where the pivoting legs were going to go. So I took my first pivoting leg and I flushed it up to the front of the boom using a straight edge and a speed square. Then I went ahead and I made a mark for two screws, one on each boom piece of that leg. Now I had a template piece and I was going to use this leg to mark the holes of the remaining pivoting legs and also the boom pieces. Starting with a smaller drill bit will help me with accuracy of drilling the holes right, and then two, since I'm using this as a template, that smaller hole will allow me to transfer more accurate marks to the remaining legs. And I do this by basically butting the angle legs up in the right position and using a Sharpie to mark a hole through the holes I drilled. I also take this template piece back over to the boom and then use a Sharpie to mark the holes on each boom piece, and I repeat this process for the other side of the boom as well. I can now go ahead and drill out the holes to the full quarter inch side, and I did this just using a cordless drill. To drill the holes on the boom pieces, I waited until I had access to a drill press. I started with a small bit, an 1/8 inch bit, and then I worked my way up to a 3-inch bit, and that's how I got my holes in the boom. I took these brass grommets that I found, and they happen to have a 3-inch outside diameter. I slid these grommets into the boom pieces where the holes were drilled. And what these grommets were gonna do, they're gonna serve almost like a bearing. This is gonna be where our pivoting would take place on our camera crane. So now I could loosely assemble the apparatus. And basically all I did is I threaded some bolts through the pivoting legs as well as the boom sections. And then I just used regular nuts for the time being to hand tighten them down to get a basic idea of how this thing would move. And now I could check the basic movement, and it seemed to work fairly well already. I cut two pieces of 2-inch angle to a length of about 4 inches. And I figured this would work well for both a camera mount as well as a foundation mount. And remember, when you're cutting metal with a hacksaw, angle grinder, or anything, it's gonna leave a sharp edge. And I was reminded about this when I cut these pieces. And so I went ahead and I took a file and I softened the edges down as best I could. It's not funny, okay? It hurt. I cut my thumb. Are you happy? Next, I position the rig in an upright configuration. I lay one of the 4-inch pieces on the top of the pivoting legs. And it doesn't matter what side it is, you do the same thing for both sides. And then I take a level and I adjust the bracket until I see that it's in a level position, and then I mark a line to reference that level mark. Then what I did is I marked the center of the side of the bracket that would mount to either the camera or the foundation. After that point, I marked the holes where the bracket would attach to the pivoting legs. Once all my holes are marked, I go ahead and I disassemble the rig again, and I drill all the holes to a size of 1/4 inch. I then go ahead and I reassemble the whole unit, including the base brackets, using 1/4 inch bolts and nuts. For the final assembly, I use nylon line nuts for the bolts, and I snug them down just enough so I'd have a nice fluid movement. So I tested it out on a pretty sturdy tripod, and for the most part, it worked fairly well. The whole point of me wanting to use this on a tripod was to get rotational movement out of the tripod head. But I was a little heavy already without the camera on it, and I didn't think a tripod was going to be enough for when I actually mounted a bigger camera, especially a DSLR camera. So I got in the mindset where I was going to go ahead and build something custom for this, and I had a conversation with KnopTop over at QuickFX, and he recommended looking into a speaker stand. This particular stand out of the box looks like a beefy tripod. There's nowhere for us to really attach this crane rig to it. Fortunately, they manufacture a specific speaker base for these types of stands. I threaded a 1/4-inch bolt through the center of the stand, slipped that bolt through the bottom of our crane foundation, and I used a butterfly nut to tighten it down to secure those things together. Now I could check the movement of the crane on this secure foundation. What was great about this is this speaker stand not only allowed me to get fluid up and down movement, but it also allowed me very fluid rotational movement. We do need counterweight to offset the weight of our lever and our camera equipment. Basic Filmmaker makes a very similar crane to this, and in his video, he uses PVC to mount his weights. Turns out I happen to have some weights from some home exercise equipment. No, Stuart, it's not just decorative. Thank you. I use it. I've used it for exercise before. Anyway, these weights, the hole inside of them actually fits snugly on 1/2-inch PVC fittings. I got a 1/2-inch PVC cap and a 1/2-inch PVC coupling. I drilled a 1/4-inch hole through the cap piece and I threaded a 1/4-inch bolt through that. I then took that 1/4-inch bolt and cap combination and threaded it through the hole I drilled in the boom for our counterweight system. Now I simply snugged up the cap and bolt using a butterfly nut. Once that was secure, I went ahead and I pressed on firmly the PVC coupling. So now I had a completely functional rig. It moves very smoothly up and down and rotationally. So anyway, there it is. That's it. It works very well. And I'm going to show you a few test shots now. Now this first shot is shooting at 24 frames per second, and this is the real movement. So here's at 60 frames, slowed down at 24 frames. And I really think it gives her a real drama feel to the footage. So I'm happy I can do this now with the crane I built. I hope you guys enjoyed this, and if so, please subscribe. And I'm Joe Kistel. Thanks for watching. How am I supposed to know how they get the holes in Swiss cheese? I don't appreciate that comment you made about the weight set. Maybe it's mice. Mice like cheese. Maybe they let the mice chew some holes in it, like tunnels or something.
Mm-mm.
No, I got it. They take dry ice cubes. While the cheese is in juice form, they mix the dry ice balls in it. Then they allow the cheese to solidify. And then what happens is the dry ice sublimates, it's a big word, and basically evaporates into carbon dioxide, leaving that cavity behind. That's gotta be how they do it, Stuart. I'm 100%. Or maybe it's the mice.